exclusive interviews with celebrities. Music Online Magazine Moose Business.
Hi everybody, I recently got acquainted with Vince and was fascinated by his artworks and management approach. At the moment, Vince has recently launched and is operating a medium-sized label called Philosophy. Besides, he is doing some mastering and production. Also, he is a professional designer. Just wow. Vince, hello.
Hello.
Well, how do you manage to mix all that together? I mean, design, production, management, promotion, etc.
I know it seems a lot, but for me, it kind of all started natural. I mean, I did graphic design and music since I was 12 years old or something. Mm-hmm. And then when I turned 18, kind of business got thrown into the mix, you know? And I've just been combining the three things, graphic design, music, and business. So for me, it's a natural evolution, so to speak.
Anyway, great. Starting from the importance of visual communication, could you please mention the main mistakes that artists usually do in that direction?
The main mistake I think that most artists do, they want an amazing look, but they don't want to pay anything for it, or they want some friend to do it or something. And the other thing that people do wrong, I think, is switching over. Like, they keep switching logos, they keep switching styles and stuff like that. And for someone viewing an artist or listening to an artist for the first time, they link the image and the sound together in their mind and match up, and it's always different. It will never build up a rapport. So when you see, for example, Skrillex with 7 different logos, you don't to the name Skrillex per se, you just link it to some new guy. You know? But when you see his logo times somewhere, it's burned into your mind, it's branded. And I think this is a big important step for people who want to do professional visual communication on their Facebook, on their social media profiles. The logo and the style of the covers, or from the YouTube banners or whatever you want to call it, need to be in the same line. There needs to be some kind of direction, you know? I will show you some examples. Okay, so let's start with audio porn. They have their logo on each cover, and it's either like this or in a circle. So it's always very clear that it's audio porn. And they have a very visual approach to the graphic designs. There's a lot of light effects, which is why why they want me to work for them, is because there's a lot of light effects. There's a lot of subtle lighting, also coloration, you know. It's very colorful, but it's still a little bit dark, you know. Mm-hmm. And in that same vein, I'll show you the Pleo Never Divide cover. You can still recognize it's audio porn. There's also, you know, there's a lot of colors and everything, but the design is different, but it's still branded that way, you know? Another example from audio porn, if I can find it, is...
Are these all examples to your artworks?
Yeah, these examples are my artworks. Mm-hmm. I wish I can...
They look really great.
Thank you. I wish I can show you the thumbnails, actually. That would be much easier also. Another one that does it really well, I think, is Viper Records. They always have the logo in big, either at the middle, at the bottom, or at the sides. They also have a very unique style. It is really similar, of course, to audio porn, because they also hire me to do it, and I have my own style, of course. But what I'm saying is there needs to be some kind of a red line running through the artwork that you can see that it's a promise of quality to the listener. You cannot just switch from a really cheap artwork to a really intricate, detailed one. It doesn't work. It breaks the promise of quality. And this is something I think every artist should keep in mind. another really good label is Simplify Recording. This has never been showed before. This is the first time I show it to someone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is the EP of Evoke coming out on Simplify Recordings. And it's very different, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it still looks like a Simplify Recordings cover. It is much more colorful, like the background is filled with color, you know, as opposed to just being really dark. And I think it makes Simplify that much more recognizable. Another one I can show you. Let's see here. Hero Kingdom. This is also Simplify Recordings. It's a little bit more, more simple, I guess you can call it. There's big logo of Kero Kingdom, which use this logo all the time. And their fans know it. This is why I want to show you this. They can put this logo without the word Kero Kingdom and people would still recognize it. And I think this is very important if you're going to do visual communication for your music or for your label or something like this. I will show you some examples of my label, maybe. This is Kimson Tripwack, and they have always the parental advisory because they have naughty lyrics. And obviously the Philosophy Recordings logo is branded at the top. And this is like that for every of these covers. I'll try to see the logo is here. Same here. So when people see these covers, they can immediately recognize that it's Philosophy Recordings cover. And I think this is just essential for success to break through. So yeah, this is pretty much it. This is pretty much the rules that I adhere to and that I would recommend to everyone to use for sure.
Yes, actually, I was fascinated by that butterfly.
The butterfly, that's coming on, if it's not released yet, it is coming on Viper Records and is the new single of Inside Info. I'll show it to you again. Metamorphosis. They wanted like a Rorschach image.
Yeah.
Something beautiful in there, so I chose a butterfly and cut out the wings and did the trashy elements.
Really, all those artworks you showed, they gonna make me stop and listen to the track at least, I guess, because
that's what I hope. That's at least is my goal. I think it should be the goal of the graphic designer to make sure that music is clicked on in shops or selected from a rack, you know, and gets preferred over other tracks because of the artwork, and because. Obviously, when you walk into a store, you're not going to immediately listen to the tracks while you see the cover. You're going to see the cover first and say, oh, you know, maybe this is something I would like to listen to. And especially with online stores, this is more important than ever now, you know? There's so much choice.
So design is like a first communication and a first impression of the track people haven't heard yet.
Right? Yeah, I think so.
Really helpful and interesting. What are the typical mistakes when the artist gives the design brief?
I think there is no such thing as a bad briefing. I think it is up to the artist, the graphic designer, and only the graphic designer to get a conversation going with the client and say, okay, so maybe we can brainstorm and find like a really good concept for the track that you like the idea of. And then only you can start working out an idea, sketching and things like this. I think it's important for a good relation with a client as a graphic designer to they want. I think if you're just going to do your own style and not taking account what you know the client wants, then there's no real value in having this person as a graphic designer. I think this is it should be like this in my opinion.
Well, returning to the management and promotion questions, you have quite a different point of view of how the things are going on in music business right now. Could you share it, please?
But I think the way that music is being sold is terribly, terribly bad. the model is completely flawed, in my opinion. The pirates and the sharers and the downloaders, they're great because they are fans, but they are doing much more damage than they possibly can imagine. I think good evolution would be to make more use of streaming, for example, rather than sales. What people who download don't always realize, of course, is a lot of money goes into promoting a release, and a lot of money goes, and time, of course, goes into making the release. And when they start sharing this, they are taking away motivation for the artist to make something fantastic. Because for many artists, there is no gigs, they don't get booked, not all of them get booked. And because they don't get booked, there is very little incentive left to produce music. So when all the sharing is going on and sales are dwindling and all this, labels might lose interest, artists might lose interest. And I think people are just missing out on a great deal of fantastic music that they could have had if sometimes they would purchase some music. But this is not only the only thing. I think, for example, iTunes and the distributors are taking much too big of a share of what is essentially already a very small piece of the cake. An average release for me costs about 200 to 300 euros to promote. And in sales, I don't think I've ever made it back, okay? The sales are, it's not that the sales are super bad. I would say they're average for a label of our age, like 2 years old. But it would have been a much different story if this was, and of course I am old, I'm 31, but if this happened like 15 years ago, we would be having artists that were making good money, you understand? Mm-hmm. So maybe the system, the way music is sold now, is completely flawed, and maybe there should be like a new approach to finding an incentive for fans for not sharing, for streaming the music rather than downloading the music. And I think Spotify is doing a good job with that. If it were not so that they are not paying artists almost anything. But I think there will be a lot of incentives for artists to be on streaming websites who will pay decent royalties, where it is impossible to download any music. It's only possible, for example, play the music. I think this will happen in the future much more.
Okay, I see. And for instance, you have a DJ with a terrific production and incredible lives. How would you make this project successful?
First thing that I would do is I always hire professional people to do something. If it's a agent, or it is someone who is good with building mailing lists, or if it's someone good with building websites, or anything that you need done, I think you should hire a professional for, because pretty much you're wasting your time. I mean, you can do it five times over, but I find it much easier to have people with knowledge and experience come in and say, hey, this is how you need to do it. I've tested 5 million other ways. This is the best one, you know? And I think you should also be able to trust those people and work with them on a long-term basis. I think this, this eliminates much problems, because I've learned a lot, of course, by managing the label. But I've also learned a lot of what not to do. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the rules that you have to set is you need professional people with knowledge that you can count on. Also, like if I want to call someone at night for a problem, I need to be able to do this. And I think you should find people always that have your back, that want to help you forward. And obviously you need to pay them well, of course, but I think it's worth it. Next that I would do to make it successful, I think, is you need to invest time. You can hire the best people, but it doesn't mean you have to lay down, you know? Like, you have to be engaged yourself and think of new ideas, think of new ways to promote this artist. And it's hard because there are many good artists. But you have to find something that your artist is the best at, and I would say put that to the foreground in every possible situation. And I think this makes the difference between having someone who is average and someone who is amazing. I think you have to find the strengths and then work on the strengths, for sure.
Very biased approach, really. And how to arrange the booking if the demand is a lot more than proposition?
I don't think there is one way. I mean, it's, in my opinion, there is one rule for the booking, and it's who you know determines what you will be doing, and in that try to get to know as much as people possible, and obviously you become friends over time. And I think this is very crucial even in finding success for the project you do or anything you undertake. The more people you know, the better you will succeed, I think. Also in this case.
Yeah, but what will make the clubs choose or promoters choose exactly your artist, for example, if they have plenty of artists pretty similar?
Yeah, these days I don't believe they can be convinced with just showing quality, because first of all you need to get them to listen to it or view a video or something, which is already extremely difficult. Second of all, it seems to me that what really counts with the promoters is the amount of people they will get to the club. Foremost and secondary is only the quality they present. And I think this is a bad evolution because, as you well know, likes can be bought or you know, followers can be bought and everything. So we end up with a culture that prefers to have large numbers on an artist that they book rather than loving the artist that they book. I just think this is a dangerous evolution because it singles out so many incredible artists. Like on my label, there is an artist called Sam Laxton. And I think it really is time for him to shine. He is also pulling in the fans on his Facebook page and everything, but he's not doing anything fake to increase fans or increase fan base or followers. And I think because of it, the mail outs that I've done for him were not as successful as I would hope. Obviously there are people who would love to see him live, but the booking agents see his profile and say, oh, we only have 5,000 fans, we won't book you then. And in my opinion, it's a shame, because if they would listen to his music, they would see, like, oh, wow, this guy is on a next level, you know, we need to book him. Like, and this is how it was, like, I would say 15, maybe even 20 years ago. This is what was most important, you know? Mm-hmm. I think the booking agents kind of lost touch with presenting what they love and kind of got into the whole cult of booking the artist with the biggest amount of fans that where they can make money off. And I think it's a silly situation and sad situation also.
Okay, but anyhow, we should somehow fight with it, with this situation. What do you think about all that follow me virus around? There's too much EDM producers right now with pretty similar stuff, and it seems to me that this number is growing quite fast each day. What are we gonna face in a couple of years with such a tempo?
Okay, well, it's interesting. I mean, I think in general, this is the fault of the labels. This is the error of the labels, because you know, people seem to argue that there has to be more quality control to filter out the amount of producers. But I think it is much more than this. I think the label should have merit to exist. If a label is just going to pick up or scoop up all the artists that they see on the surface, you know, and if they just release the same sort of music as everyone else does, then I don't think that label should exist, because it's not bringing anything extra to the table, not bringing anything extra to the scene as a whole. You know, with Philosophy Recordings, I try, or at least I sign artists that sound like nobody else. In fact, this is my first rule. They have to sound like nobody else. They have to have their own sound, their own style. And secondary is that when I sign a track, I have to feel that it breaks boundaries. It does something different than other labels or other music does. And I don't think enough labels do that. I think labels need to keep in mind that the labels create a certain flavor of music, like Firepower did. You know, they created the demand for really heavy, aggressive dubstep, and they did this very well. I think from the branding to the releasing of tracks and the promotion of tracks and building the fan base. Excision is a great example also. I think he does it even better. But when labels start to do this more and more, then I think fans will have a much broader perspective on dance music, on EDM. And this vicious circle, I guess I can call it, of sounds that all sound, they all sound the same, you know. And I think this vicious circle will finally break, and it will music and different music to fans. And I don't think that Follow Me virus, as you say, will be a big problem then. I think there is just too much of people copying each other and not enough producers doing what they want to do. And I think if we would have that, then people wouldn't have to say, hey, follow me, and you know, they would just get followers because they're doing something interesting.
And also, what's the limit to not being original too much? I mean, that even the stores might reject you to put your stuff to those stores because you are not within the style, something like true. That.
Absolutely true. You know, rejection is a part of life. I don't know if I can make it any prettier than this, but if you are willing to get rejected 20 times, one day you will succeed. And I think if you are betting everything on everything and doing what you feel you should be doing, and even if that's making, like, I don't know, like a mix of electro and country or something like Avicii has been doing, I think you will be successful one day, and nobody will be able to take your throne because there's no replacement for you. But right now, people are trying to take each other strong. They're trying to take the first place in the EDM top 100 or EDM top 10 on Beatport. And because of it, they are just copying each other. And it's like inbreeding, you know. It doesn't create anything decent. It just creates something that is good for another week of throwaway music. You know what I mean? But you understand me, right?
Yeah, quite understanding, but what about another kind of strategy, like you do something quite similar to the others, but in a different way? So you get the brand, you develop your brand, you get the fans, and then eventually you start doing something really different. So, but by that time, you already have your fans, you already have a known brand. I mean. So yeah. That would be much more simple, I guess.
Well, simple, yes, but you have to keep in mind, like, the fans that first found you, will they still be interested in your new music? Because essentially, otherwise, you're just building a new fan base and singling out maybe like the first 4,000 or 5,000 that you already have. So is it interesting to do in the long term, or is it worth to invest in the beginning to have an original sound, to build an original fan base? I think an artist in our label, Modix, actually, is doing this very well. He has a very, very active fan base. His music doesn't sound like anything else. It is a mixture of chip tune and dubstep and electro and house, and it just sounds like him. Every track that you play, just you can recognize his style. And I think what he did very well was never to make the mixture too, how to say, in the function of success. He just made what you want to make, and people seem to like it, you know, and because of this, he has a very active and very loyal fan base. I think this is much more important to have.
So, and about the promotion, what's your favorite promo tool? Do you consider the JML out to be a nice option?
Well, the promo tools, I think, are the free ones. Not because they are free, but because they have they already have functionality. I use MailChimp often, and I use it to mail blogs, I use it to mail promoters, I use it to make a list of people that I want to mail in the future. I think MailChimp is very, very useful. But next to this, just social media. I Dropbox tracks to people on SoundCloud to promote. I use just the messaging function of YouTube to promote my tracks, just by emailing someone, you know, messaging someone a link to the track and saying, hey, you know, if you want to promote this, I send you the download and the info for it. But I don't think there's very much tools that you pay for that are worth it. I tried some Twitter following bots. It didn't work. I mean, even though it was built for music, it just didn't give me the fans that I wanted to reach. And I also think paying for things on Facebook is pretty stupid as well. I mean, to promote things on Facebook and paying for them is basically throwing your money away. I've tried it many times. It's true. I know you're laughing, but it's true. I tried it many times.
I agree with you.
Well, the thing is that
Facebook is watching us.
Yeah. Even if it's, you know, even if it's aimed at your own fan base, the problem with Facebook is that there's many people just getting the advert or whatever you want to call it in their feed, but never really taking a look or listen, you know. But even for them to get it in their feed, Facebook is charging money. So essentially, you're just paying, you know, 100% just to get like a 2% result, which is insane, in my opinion. It's better to use free tools. By the way, I know SoundCloud is you know, you have to pay for it. I'm just saying, once you pay for it, the messaging function is free. You can contact anyone and send anything to anyone that you want. Obviously, SoundCloud by itself is a fantastic tool. So,
in your opinion, does the radio and broadcasting still have reason? Or it's better to focus on popular EDM groups and sites?
I think even more than used to be. I think this is more important now. Because, like I said, with many illegal downloads and everything, radio broadcasting, if you do it right, you know, it can generate income streams where social media falls short. You know, if I haven't set it up properly for philosophy recordings because I want to do much more, but it's a very long process. But if you do it right, I think you can get much more money for the tracks you release or want to promote than just to have it on social media, for sure. Yes.
What services do you use for copyright registration and protection? Could you share, please?
I think unless you are doing extreme amount of sales, I think copyright registration is pretty much useless. And I know people will disagree with me, I know that. But proof of copyright actually exists as soon as you make the track. Okay? It's like the artist doesn't have to do anything special, it exists. But you can claim copyright and everything, but it, of course, in court it's difficult. However, if you have a contract or a paper claiming copyright between a label and an artist, for example, saying, hey, artist A says that label B, you know, will sign this track and this track, and artist A has all the legal rights to go into this agreement, then you have officially copyrighted your track, simple as that. But there are royalty collectors and licensors who you need to register for copyright with, I think, who are worthy for their money, but it is a different story because the sales have to be much higher for it to be interesting.
Thanks for the interview that you spent your time with us and shared some of your really, really helpful knowledge. So maybe you'd like to say something in the end to our subscribers. Mostly they are producers and DJs.
Sure. Well, first of all, if you have any good music, feel free to send it to Philosophy Recordings, obviously. Second of all, I hope that you found it interesting, my views, and I hope that it's useful for you in the future. And I would say, if you want to achieve something in the music industry, whether it's being, you know, a producer or an engineer or a graphic designer, I think there is no better time than now to get started and really do it day by day for it to be successful.
Okay, that was great. Thank you again.
Bye-bye.
And don't forget to subscribe for this great guy on Facebook and SoundCloud.